important book that came out that was written by Rachel Botsman and Rue Rogers laid out the concept of collaborative consumption in a pretty authoritative way. Their book was called What's Mine is Yours, and it put the whole vision of collaborative consumption into perspective. The authors assert in this book that the trends that gave rise to collaborative consumption were basically fourfold. The first was a recognition of the importance of community. Community being something that people began to value, started to recognize that was something that didn't come for free, and that was something that people wanted to achieve. The second trend was the availability of peer-to-peer social networks that could update and communicate in real time. Facebook being an example of one that enables the sharing of information and pictures and links, but peer-to-peer social networking that exchange information in real time aren't just limited to Facebook. They can be used to support collaborative consumption. The third trend is growing environmental concerns and the recognition that there are other ways of consuming and managing inventory that have less impact on the environment. The fourth trend was the global recession that happened in the 2008 time period into the early 2010s. And this caused people to think about ways of living their life that would require less money and possibly involve more sharing. So those were the basic four trends that were laid out in the book as far as the things that gave rise to collaborative consumption. Importance of community, peer-to-peer real-time social networks, environmental concerns, and the global recession. In addition to these trends, there are three categories of businesses that do collaborative consumption can be put into. The first one is redistribution markets. So this is the idea of not just reduce, reuse, recycle, but also adding on to those three R's, the idea of repair and redistribution. So redistribution markets are those kinds of collaborative consumption markets that involve sending used and unneeded items to those that want them. All right, so that's one thing, one way in which collaborative consumption happens, redistribution. Another way that collaborative consumption happens is through collaborative lifestyles, and this focuses more on the community aspect of the trends that were identified in What's Mine is Yours. Collaborative lifestyles include things like co-working, people who only need an office space for a short amount of time but would like to be around people. Time banking, in which people exchange services not for money, but in exchange for, I'll spend an hour doing what I'm good at if you'll spend an hour doing what you're good at in exchange for each other. Couch surfing being an example of a collaborative lifestyle. This is an exchange of a place to live, but it also is a community living kind of arrangement because there's someone sleeping on your couch. And then another example of this would be land share, where you have a backyard that you'd like to offer to someone else to farm. This is as much about utilizing the backyard as it is about meeting new people and living in community together. The last kind of category for collaborative consumption would be product service systems. So this is, for example, fashion collaborative consumption, where we trade fashion items for short periods of time, we trade tools in a sharing basis, Netflix, examples of product service systems that use collaborative consumption. Now, as you might imagine, as you've seen probably just in popular media, Silicon Valley and venture capitalists are all over this because for the most part, they're low investment business opportunities in which marketplaces are central and the ability to connect consumers with producers to provide services in the middle and to facilitate those monetary transactions is a potentially lucrative market. So a very, very popular idea in Silicon Valley. So because of that, you have people like Kevin Kelly who are extolling the idea that access is better than ownership. This is the idea that ownership actually comes with hidden costs of maintenance and storage and depreciation and excess capacity. And actually, it might be better if you just had access to these services and these items and these tools and these entertainment venues rather than having to own them yourself. Of course, there are TED Talks that gasp breathlessly about how the future of business is sharing and all the different ways in which this is going to revolutionize everything we're doing. There are MIT entrepreneurship experts that are saying things like the following. One of the best ways to return to a sustainable way of life is to maximize asset use through collaborative consumption marketplaces by providing economic incentives to maximize efficiency, binding large communities to shared causes, and decreasing total consumption, collaborative consumption will become a cornerstone, a keystone of a sustainable American society. So in some ways, these people are absolutely right. There are vast amounts of latent value in the things that we own, and being able to use them more efficiently can be the cornerstone of a new business models and a sustainable future. However, it's important not to get too excited out of perspective of what's happening here, because let's not forget that people have been sharing things for a long time. You can compare a laundromat to Zipcar. Laundromats have been around for quite a while, and a laundromat is a way of sharing a washer and dryer in the way that Zipcar is a way of sharing cars. Rather than owning your own washer and dryer, you go to a central location and use a centrally managed inventory of washers and dryers. This is the sharing economy without calling it the sharing economy. Libraries. Libraries are just like Netflix, but for books. Libraries have been around for thousands of years and are an example of a sharing or a collaborative consumption environment, economy, if you will, that have been around for a long time that we haven't been calling that. Bed and breakfasts have been around for tens of years, probably longer than that if you consider them boarding houses. And these are places where people own houses that have excess capacity. They buy houses that have excess capacity so that they can act as a landlord, as a host, as hospitality to travelers who are coming through. And this is just like Airbnb, perhaps without the scale and without the reputation management that was associated. But it was a sharing economy, and it's been around for quite a while. So that gets to the point of what's different here. What's different about collaborative consumption in the way that we're talking about it today? Well, one thing that's different is scale. The number of customers, the number of goods, the number of locations, and the speed of information transmission is all higher than it's ever been before. It's completely feasible right now to have a directory, a database, that lists every single person in the world. It might be difficult to make that happen socially, but from a technical standpoint, scaling a database to 7 billion entries is not difficult. That also means that the number of places that Airbnb or Zipcar can handle is much higher than it was when the directories had to be paper, or when they had to be updated every 6 months rather than every minute. Another difference, as I mentioned a moment ago, is reputation management. One of the things that these services provide that is quite valuable is a way to know whether or not the person that you're connecting with can be trusted. So if you would like to offer a room in your house to someone as rent, you would like to have some assurance that they're a responsible, safe, reliable renter before you open up your home to that person. Before you hire someone, like in the service Lyft, to drive you around in their car, you might like to know a little bit about that person and what they do and what other people have said about them. Before you let someone farm your backyard, before you let them come through your home and take over your backyard for gardening, you might like to know a little bit about them. And so a lot of these services offer reputation management through reviews and stars and various reliability indicators that hasn't been available before. So that is different about the current sharing economy than what we saw in the libraries and the laundromats in the past. Well, although there's a lot of potential with collaborative economies, and many people are very excited about the way in which they're supporting new ways of interacting with each other and possibly a sustainable future, not everyone agrees that collaborative consumption is a wonderful future. Recently, there have been a lot of critiques that have pointed out that these collaborative consumption services are monetizing things that used to be supported through public programs, through collective political action, and through collective governance. A lot of these services are making their money off of things that used to be public goods, that used to be public infrastructure, and in the process of doing that, they're also bypassing many of the regulations that have been designed over time in order to support the kind of community goals that we have and to support all the interests of various stakeholders that are involved in these sharing economies. So what the heck am I talking about? Let me give you a couple grounded examples. So we talked earlier about the example of Car2Go. Car2Go is like Zipcar, but there's not a particular parking space where Car2Go cars stay. When you're done with Car2Go cars, you leave them wherever they happen to be if they're in a legal parking spot, and the tracking technology in it will let the Car2Go company know where they are and let people who would like to rent the cars next know where they are. Well, that's fine, but what Car2Go is doing then is they're using public parking spaces that used to be available to everyone as a place to store their inventory of cars. So rather than having to buy a parking garage or a lot where they store all the cars when they're not being used, this public good, which used to be the free parking spot, has now been co-opted by Car2Go, who's making money off while they're storing their cars there. Netflix, is another example. They're the post office's largest commercial mail client. And by virtue of being such a large commercial mail client, Netflix was able to negotiate aggressive rates for their ubiquitous red mailers. Their DVD delivery business couldn't have existed if the post office, which was started as a public entity and as a public good, and in many ways is still regulated by public and collective governance, Netflix benefits from that tremendously. They don't have their own delivery mechanism for getting their physical DVDs to you. A final example relates to the regulations that are being bypassed by these services. So there are laws and regulations that prevent hotels from doing things that we collectively think are bad. For example, hotels can't discriminate against different types of customers. There are regulations in place that prevent that from happening. Well, peer-to-peer hospitality services like Airbnb don't have any regulations that prevent someone from not allowing a person whom they would like to discriminate against from staying in their home. If you have a room in your home, you can discriminate against the people that stay there any way that you like. And the regulations aren't in place to prevent that, and they would be difficult to enforce in any regard. So there are some things that we have built in for safety collective moral imperatives that are bypassed by some of these services. Another big critique is that of the labor conditions that are associated in collaborative consumption. So there's a lot of wage compression and decline in working conditions for the people that decide that they're going to offer their services through these collaborative consumption environments. Many of the people who drive for Uber and Lyft, for example, are otherwise unemployed, or they don't have or can't find jobs that have a living wage. There have been various sort of gaffes from the executives of these companies where they suggest that elementary school teachers can pick up a job at night driving for Uber or Lyft so that they can pull in a few extra dollars so that they can have a living wage. So this is a way of compressing wages rather than trying to find a way that our teachers can be paid a living wage. Some of these drivers are vulnerable, sometimes they're very desperate, and the companies that run these services, they don't pay benefits that a traditional corporation would pay, they don't provide disability insurance, they generally don't contribute to health insurance, and across the board, venture capitalists love low-cost labor, and this is a way of getting low-cost labor and bypassing regulations that have been put in place to protect workers. These arrangements tend to drive down the standard of living of many workers along the way. Uber and Lyft are causing seismic shifts in the taxi industry. They push much of the risk that used to be borne by corporate customers onto the workers. While the workers are buying and maintaining the means of production, for example, they're buying and maintaining the cars for Lyft and Uber, they don't have the same access to resources to write off these assets in depreciation on their taxes the way companies do, because that requires expensive lawyers and accountants in order to help you do those sorts of things that most of these drivers don't have access to. And so it's important to realize that with all the potential of collaborative consumption, there's also some bad things that come with it as well that need to be carefully monitored if we want to have a just and sustainable future. So in summary, collaborative consumption is the ability for individuals and businesses to monetize excess capacity in the goods that they own or control and the time that they have. So you have excess capacity, you can make money off it. It occurs in a wide swath of domains. All kinds of industries are doing this, recognizing that there's excess capacity and trying to monetize that by sharing and trading and renting out these excess capacity. It's enabled through modern information technology, because that modern information technology is what enables us to manage the scale, the reputation, and the real-time communication that's necessary for these things to happen. It also happens to support the payment for those services that require transaction costs. If the impact of this is to drastically reduce manufacturing and non-renewable consumption, then the impact is going to be great for sustainability. And as long as we can help mitigate the downsides, there's a lot of potential for collaborative consumption to revolutionize the way that we're doing business, possibly pretending a more sustainable future. Thank you very much.